Well, good morning, everyone. My name is Raymond Leach, and I'm with Salem Stones. I've been with Salem Stones a couple of years. Prior to that, I worked for Cold Spring for 18 years, and then prior to that, I was in the monument business. So, been in the industry a long time. They asked me to talk about cremation ideas. That's something that I've worked on for 20 years. So we're going to talk about that today. I put together a presentation, and most of it obviously is all products that I've worked with at Salem, because that's what I have access to. However, we also have information on the back table from not only my company, but from Matthews and from Cold Spring on their cremation products. So some of the things we're going to talk about today, obviously you can get those from other companies also. Okay? And then I kind of wanted to make it interactive, so if you're doing anything in cremation that's unique or that you'd like to share with us, I'd appreciate it. Or if you have any questions, just feel free to interrupt me. Okay. Go ahead, Scott. So cremation statistics, obviously we've talked about this for years, right? The rate of cremation continues to increase and is projected to surpass burial in 2015 from the NFDA. Okay, so this, the statistics I have are 2015. So as you can see here, projected cremation as we go through by the year 2030, we're looking at 56% and then 38% for burial. Okay, I know we're all talking about it. For some of us, and hopefully, fortunately, that's me, it won't change my work drastically before I retire. But for probably several of us in here, that 20 years from now, your job is going to be a lot different because of cremation. Okay. Some questions I have here, has the increase in cremation burials affected your gross income? Okay, so when we talk to cemeteries about what cremation is doing for them, I mean, what challenges there are, usually your net income is affected by that. Has it affected that? What type of cremation dispositions are occurring at your cemetery? Okay. Is there anybody in here that's not doing cremation? Okay, everybody's doing cremation, right? Is there anyone in here, obviously you're doing cremation, but you really don't have very many options for people? Okay, so a few people, okay. Do you offer cremation niches? Scattering gardens or any place other than standard ground burial for cremation. Okay, so those are things to think about. What is the long-term plan for cremation disposition at your cemetery as the rate of cremation increases? You need to have a long-term plan. It's not going to go away. You're going to have families come in and they're looking for you for a solution.
Something like that too, just that planning process, you know. Figure out, your land, sometimes with home burials or scattered garden, figure out land that maybe you're not going to be utilizing for a burial ground layout would be a good revenue, source using that land for a cremation option.
Right.
And then start the budget for it, because I know budgets are tight. So maybe do like a 5-year plan, start setting money back for 5 years. That way, when you go to move forward with that project, that money's set aside where you're not asking your trustees or your city council, hey, I need $40,000 this year. Or, so if you start laying that money back or setting it back over a period of time, it can be a lot easier to get approved.
Right. Good point, Scott. So identify areas in your cemetery that you cannot use for traditional burial. Those are ideal spots for cremation. And like Scott said, if you start planning for it, budgeting for it, you can develop those areas. One of the things, and we'll get into this more in the presentation, but I have consistently seen it over and over the years. If you build it, they will come. And when I say that, the thing is most people that have family members that are cremated, because you're obviously dealing with a living, they don't know what to do with the cremains or they're not sure, but if they see a nice area, okay, they can buy into the value of that. If you don't have anything to show them, or you've kind of started something, but there's really not much in there, they have a hard time, really buying into that. But if you build it and it's a beautiful area, then they feel comfortable, like, this is great, that's where I want mom to be, I love this area, etc. You provided a solution for them, okay? Are your cemetery customers asking for other options besides burial or cremation? Okay? So maybe some of you, your customers are asking you. One of the real challenges, obviously, is, you know, 20%, I think, is the number of people that are cremated or not even going to a cemetery. And that might be a low number. It might be higher than that. However, what's going to happen a lot of times is people are going to think about, okay, I've had dad on the mantle for 15 years. I got to do something with him. What am I going to do with him? And that's where if you have solutions for those people, you can start capturing some of those cremains. How many full burial and cremation remains do you allow on one grave? Okay. Does anybody allow a second rite of interment? Does everybody allow a second rite of interment? Okay, great. Do you charge for that?
Yes.
Okay, great. A third? Anybody allow a third? Okay. Great.
One and two.
One. Okay.
Full and two.
And two cremains.
One and three.
Do you charge for those two? Okay. Anybody allow four? Okay. So you got that unlimited. As many as you can put on there. Okay.
Is it a full space?
Yeah, we used to allow actually six.
Six.
If there was no.
If there's no full burial.
Yeah,
okay.
I think we want to go to four because what we're finding is so many people want to put flush markers for each individual cremation that it's just too much. And if they don't pre-plan it, then it's just a nightmare because they start out, hey, mom and dad's going to be, and then they find out, then they say, well, we heard you could do four or six.
Okay.
And you start out, you know, in a straight line instead of like a six pack, you know, out of eight. And it just becomes a huge headache. So you really want to pre-plan and lower our numbers and the revenue.
Right. Yeah, so the revenue, I mean, revenue is important, obviously, because we need the money to put back into the cemetery to maintain it. And so that's a very good point. You know, how are you going to manage people in those second or third rite of interments where you're allowing it on a grave? And that's not an ideal thing either. You know, I'm hoping we can create areas that offer value to the family. They'd rather be there than, because most people, to me, our business is no different than any other business. People come in, I don't have a lot of money, I want the cheapest thing. My budget's $1,000, but I've seen it over and over and over because I spent time on the retail sales. Occasionally I still get involved in that. If somebody sees something of value, they can put value with it, go pay more. And it's not that you're talking them into paying more for something, it's just they've got the money, they just decided that their budget is bigger than $1,000 now because they found something they love and they want to buy that. Do you plan to offer columbarium or cremation niches as well as scattering garden options to your cemetery customers in the future? What are your thoughts as to how a cemetery will be managing cremation dispositions in 5 years or 10 years? Okay, I don't have the answers, but I've talked to a lot of people in the industry that really think, you know, 10 years from now, we're going to be doing things different. I mean, things are going to change rapidly, and that means that the types of services we provide, the way we handle cremains is going to be different, okay? Now, being on the supplier side, our biggest challenge is coming up with products, okay? Now, we can manufacture, if it can be done in Granite, we can manufacture it. But who's got the idea? And we kind of rely on customers. A lot of times the customers rely on us. Everybody's trying to come up with solutions. So cremation ideas, obviously you've got cremation gardens, and I can tell you that takes up most of my time now. It's amazing, the people that are interested in cremation gardens, and the municipal cemeteries and township cemeteries that are contacting us about cremation gardens. And they're buying a package, which I've never seen before either. Instead of just getting a 48-inch columbarium, they want a package. They want other products. They want to fill an area in the cemetery. Scattering gardens, your scattering areas. Ossuary, okay, we're doing a little more of those ossuaries for common cremains. Natural areas for cremation. What else? Can anybody else think of anything I don't have listed on here? Yes. Sure. It's a common cremains. It's basically, you can do it a couple different ways, but it's going to be a large area that you put several people's cremains in. Okay?
Yeah, co-mingling.
Yeah. And most people I know that are doing it, they actually will put the ashes like in a bag and label them. They'll put them in like a nice velvet bag. So they are co-mingled, but, you know, in the system they're putting them in, they try to keep them somewhat separate.
All of our ossuaries are separate. You take the lid off, okay. So to speak, cover. They're all individual.
Okay.
So it's not ours, we're not separate on top of each other, laying them side by side with all separate spaces.
Yeah. Avenue of the Flags in Hermit HPA, it's a veterans. They have done an ossuary for each branch of service. Oh. They drilled.
Well, yeah, God forbid a Marine's next to an Army guy, right?
But they drilled for all five branches, and...
That's a great idea, yeah.
Yeah, they actually had a drilling rig come in and drill pretty deep. Of course, the oil and gas industry was very fond and very proactive in funding this. And then each of the caps for each is the branch of service. So that's how they're doing
right.
Their cremains. It's really quite impressive to see.
Okay. Great. Good idea. Yeah, so we're seeing more of that, and you know, a lot of what we're doing a lot of is the columbariums. When we do like an octagon, 144 niche, 96 niche columbarium, the inside of that unit's hollow. So what some customers are choosing to do is to use one niche door as an access to access the center of it and then put an ossuary in the middle of that. So now instead of having, you know, 144 niches, and they could be all companions on top of that, you can get another 250 to 300 cremains inside that columbarium in an ossuary. Cremation products, we have things like urns, you've got your memorials, benches, boulders, pillars, columbaria, family columbaria, niches in existing buildings, ossuaries, name plaques for scattering. Along with the columbarium, the niches, you know, we have the glass front niches, which are really popular also. As far as I know, I have not seen one in an external setting. You know, it's always inside. But the glass front niches are very popular also. So personalized cremation bevel memorial. Here's an example of just taking a regular cremation memorial, or a regular bevel memorial, I'm sorry, or pillow marker, okay, with the lid, the top of it comes off, you put cremains inside, and then seal it. So I see this, you know, throughout the United States at different cemeteries where you're more traditional granite cemeteries where people don't want to be in the ground. They want a solution for being above ground, etc. Cremation bench options, such as your pedestal bench, cremation panel bench. Now these can be put throughout your cemetery, okay? And again, it's just another solution. There's different ways that cemeteries will sell these, okay? They'll sell them as a regular memorial, or it'll be property of the cemetery and they sell the interment rights to go inside it. So there's different ways you can approach that. But what's nice about benches is you can put them strategically throughout your cemetery. It gives families a way, you know, somewhere to put their cremains, and also it helps beautify the cemetery too. So here's a custom bench, not the best photograph. Well, we do a lot of custom stuff, and you'd be surprised at the custom things we do in cremation. Again, you do have customers that if they find something that they really like, they're willing to spend the money to have something nice.
More and more families want personal touch now.
Yeah. Cremation boulder with niches. Again, this is a good product you can put throughout the cemetery. And you typically put those around your shrubs or in areas that you can't do regular burial in. So those are popular. This granite boulder, this is from a cemetery in Kentucky, and what they did there, it's a cremation area, but the cremains are going in the ground, okay, but it's all, they're granite boulders, but they're trying to make it look real natural. And just to give you an idea, in that area, it's a very small area. They set it up so it's like a little park inside of the cemetery, so it's kind of an exclusive area, and it is not cheap to go in there. I think your family's looking at like $10,000 to go in there. They sold it all out within 2 years. Okay, but again, it's what that thing where if you have the vision and you build it and it's nice enough, okay, then families want to be there. Cremation pillars, again, the cremains go inside the pillar. You've got the custom tops that we can basically do anything you want. Your granite companies can do that. They can do, you know, custom tops to these. These are nice because they can go in cremation gardens. And again, your cremation garden, you should have several price points. This would probably be a higher price point, but it's a nice option for people. Next slide, yep, here's another one with a golfer. Columbariums, you know, we think of columbariums, 48-inch columbarium is the most common, and they get bigger, but we can do these small columbariums for small areas, okay, throughout the cemetery or an existing mausoleum. A lot of people that have mausoleums, they're looking for every available spot within their mausoleum to put, add some more niches. Something like this, you can just bring in, roll in, and put it in place. Here's another just standard, you know, columbarium. Now, one of the things about columbariums, and I'm kind of speaking for the other suppliers too, most of them would be able to customize your columbarium. So I know we can set it up however you want it. Individuals, companions, because the way we construct them, you can tell me what size niche you want. Okay, so we can make these things as large as you want. Some cemeteries want them large because they want the families to be able to put in two big urns. Okay, so there's a lot of solutions out there, because what happens when a family shows up, they have a nice urn that they bought at the funeral home, it's really big and it's too big to go in the, your cremation niche. Okay. This is in Woodlawn Cemetery. The picture is taken before they finished all the walkway around it and stuff. There's just another, I think that's 144 niche columbarium there. Here's another one. I don't have a picture of the finished product, but it turned out beautiful. It's in Fort Wayne, Indiana. Now this is, I know this is on small areas, but this is a big area, obviously. But you can also take, if you do have a big area, and what I found recently is, it's kind of hard to tell in this one, but some of the cemeteries that I've been to, they'll take a big area, but they'll section it off so that when you go into that cremation garden, you'll go from, I guess for a lack of better term, you'll go like from one room to another. So you don't feel like you're in this big area. You feel like you're more in an exclusive area. Okay. But here, I wanted to show this because there's multiple products throughout the cremation, different price points. Okay. Next one, Scott. There's another, you know, we've got statuary in there. This is in Atlanta, Georgia. So they've got, here you can see that they have the little bench areas that you can put benches in. They've got a pillar back there with an open book on top of it. So they're offering a variety of product. Next one, Scott. And here, you know, again, they just designed it with everything they're putting in there, they're designing it to put cremains in. Here's a picture of the boulder again. Put those again throughout your cemetery. Now this one, wish I had a better picture, couldn't find it, but this is a brand new cremation garden. And I wish I had taken more pictures when I was there. I should have, because they put all of our products in there. But I was time crunched that day. I'll have to go back. But they built the whole cremation garden first. Okay? And they put in 75% of the product. And because they're very particular about how they do things, that cremation garden has been in development for about a year, and they haven't started selling. It's going to start selling at the end of the month, and they've already got commitments for probably, for a lot of it. 25% or more is already sold. I mean, they haven't written the contracts, but people are wanting, there's a lot of pent-up demand because they're driving around the cemetery, you're seeing it, and they like that area. So this is just a, it's a small area, but this is just one part of that area where they put in pillars, boulders. The personal columbarium, I didn't have a picture of that up there, but the small columbarium units, those are popular. Okay. So when you have a small area, you can work with your suppliers, okay, to help you develop an idea for your cremation garden. So this particular idea here has not happened yet. I've been working with the cemetery. Our designer went to Google Maps and pulled up the area that they want to do a cremation garden in. Okay? And they said, we want to do something here. We know we want columbariums. We know we want some different products. Give us some ideas. So we're just at the starting point. And what we do is we do the design work here, the concept work, and then if the cemetery chooses to, then they'll hire a landscape architect to do the engineering. I know some cemeteries do that for themselves. Okay? But your suppliers, they can help you come up with a concept so that you can sell it to the powers that be of what you want to do. Okay, so, and here's the same area, but putting in five columbariums, benches, pillars. Now this cemetery does not sell memorialization per se. They sell cremation, they'll sell columbariums, mausoleums, but they don't sell monuments. So the benches, pillars would be probably about all that they would offer, okay, in that area. But what they've decided to do is they're going to go with five columbariums. They're going to buy three to start with, and then the other two later on. But as we narrow it down, we get more specific on the products and more specific on the renderings of what's going to go in there. So that is all that I had as far as pictures. Okay. So now I just kind of wanted to talk about, you know, what you guys are doing for cremation. And are you, as Scott pointed out, are you planning for it? Okay, because, you know, besides, the key to cremation, and I'll bring this up before I kind of open it up, is what we're really talking about here is memorializing. It's not about the cremains, it's not about the ashes. It's about memorializing, okay? And unfortunately, cremation has taken us down that path where people don't think memorializing is important anymore, okay? But for those of you that work with families, you know if you talk to them about it, they realize, you know, you're right, I need a final resting place and I need to memorialize. So anybody want to share something that you're doing in your cemetery as far as cremation?
We started a scattering garden a year ago. I believe we're almost 50% sold already.
Oh, wow. Okay.
It's really small. By our pond, we discovered a smaller pond. Of it, cleaned it all out, kind of bounded it, and put the garden slightly below it, but above the actual pond, and that's what we really love.
Okay.
So we really love.
Good. That's, yeah. So again, you know, having those areas and options for people. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I don't see too many, I mean, the scattering gardens are out there. They were, seemed like for a while, for a few years, everybody's wanted to put scattering gardens in. Now what I'm finding is people are looking at more the cremation garden concept with the different products.
We're using fiber grain mold tubes.
Fine, okay.
They actually do get to place them in ground.
Okay.
Good. Interiorates over top.
Yep. Anybody else?
I think one of the things you need to do is also consider those families that were scattered not in your cemetery. It's called a cenotaph. Cenotaph is when someone is memorialized, it's not buried in your cemetery. So when families come out and say, yeah, we've got these cremated remains, but my mom's was scattered in West Virginia or somewhere, and we don't have anywhere to go, but we can still memorialize mom and dad, whether you have the cremated remains or not. It opens up the rest of that market.
Right. Yeah, good point. Because there are people that want to memorialize, okay? I mean, you know, I know that monument dealers will have people come in, obviously, and talk about, you know, what are my options here, you know. Eventually they realize they want to memorialize, or they're not sure what they want to do, and they come in asking for advice. someone else share anything you're doing?
Yeah, I have a question about that. Because we had three requests. One, the person actually passed away as a veterans marker, so we sold them a little cremation plot. How do you, do you keep separate records on your memorializations?
They'll have an account with the memorial, but since there's no one to bury, there's no...
Just, right, it's not burial.
Right, yeah, it's just a memorial.
We keep records on people, like in memory of stones, same type of thing. That way family have that genealogy to go back to as well. So, they tell us what happened to the cremains, were they scattered someplace, buried someplace else, and we have a record of that, so when people come to us, we can say they're not here, but this is what the family did.
Okay, good. Yeah, I know Dave Chanteau, he's not in here, but he shared an idea with me yesterday. Actually, we talked about it a couple times, but you see these veterans walls that go up, or the first responders walls where families pay to have a person's name put up there, like in the communities and stuff, somebody is a veteran. But if you take that concept to cemeteries, and cemeteries were to put in a memorial wall for people that are not buried there, or they could be buried there, the key would be marketing it and letting people know you have a memorial wall. So for those people that dad wanted to be scattered on the farm, but they realized, you know what, let's put dad somewhere. Dad needs to be memorialized somewhere, that they would have a place that you could come in on the memorial wall and put that person's name and information. So that way there's a record of them, and there's a place to memorialize. And so it's kind of like the brick concept, like you're selling a brick in the wall to memorialize somebody, whether they're there or not, or however you want to do it, but you can give them recognition on that wall. Anything else anybody's doing?
We are, we're a flush bronze cemetery. We use the Matthews product, and it's called Cremorials. And the Cremorials, we've got a garden of roses that has a rose trellis to it. And underneath, we've put in these cremorials, and the bronze plate pops up, and your cremains sits right underneath the bronze plaque. It drops back down in the ground, but there's a vase. So now all of a sudden, the person's got the memorial, the cremated remains, and a vase to put flowers in whenever they want to.
Yeah, and I think Bob from Matthew, information back there on those units. And again, with any of the products, the manufacturers, for the bronze and the granite, if it can be done, they'll do it for you if you have ideas. I know a lot of things, I would say a lot of the things we do are custom in some way. Somebody has an idea, they want us to change it a little bit, so we can do that. But getting back to that concept, if you build it, they will come. In my experience, everybody's got a tough budget, but in my experience, the cemeteries that have budgeted for it or commit to it, and if they take an area and they put in like 50% of the product, now they can show families, and the families can see how beautiful of an area it is and see how nice it is, and they can, okay, now I understand why this is $2,000 and this is $5,000, but they can put a value with that dollar figure, and they can say, okay, this is what I want. And so the cemeteries that I've worked with, I've never had anybody disappointed that they did that. Usually they're telling me that within a year or two, they made back their investment. It goes pretty quick. So, but you have to... The problem, I think the challenge with cremation, and maybe I'm wrong, you guys work with the families more than I do, is the families are not in that mindset. They have no idea what they want to do. Dad wanted to be cremated. We don't want what dad wanted. We don't know what to do with them. And they're not thinking about it. But now when you can go out there and show them, we got this really nice area just for cremains. Now they can say, okay, if they like it, they can say, great, this is where I want my father to be at right here.
And once you do have a new cemetery, a lot of people are busy there. We hold an open house on a Saturday for a couple hours. That draws 1 to 4 or whatever, we're going to have an open house just for any general questions or to promote, you know, your new areas. That goes over really well.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think you're unique in the fact that Scott's at a municipal cemetery, but you're doing those things. And I know, unfortunately, a lot of municipal cemeteries are not. But, you know, it's good to do these things and let the community know what you have available. Good. Anybody else doing anything? Your cremation. Is there anything that's working for you on cremation? It doesn't have to be a cremation garden. Doesn't have to be a product. But yes.
You know, if I have any advice, really just got to listen to your community. You know, I oversee like 15 locations, and I got cemeteries where I'm pre-constructing glass front niches, and I'm raising my price point, and the community doesn't care because it's just filling up. I had two, sold them out, I'm on 8 now. Other locations, monumentally. There's so much product out there now. I use the cemetery as a display. There's just so many, you know, we can take a drive and find something you like, or you can construct your own. And then others, they're real traditional. I mean, we're just burying.
Right.
We are in real 16x24, second rank and everything. Sometimes a husband and wife, they bought two spaces, so now they're second rank into the other one, transferring to their kids. I'm guaranteed two more over here. So it's really just, you know, listen to your community and give them what they want. But they don't know what they want.
That's right. Yeah. Hey, yeah, and that, again, just in my travels, the cemeteries that do not have nice offerings, different offerings for cremation, they're the ones that are struggling the most because they just don't have a variety of offering. They're not, people come in, that's just where it stops and you're done. But as you develop areas and have different offerings, it opens that market up to you. Exactly enough. I have, you know, I had cemeteries that have put in different things. Like we had a cemetery that put in a columbarium that looks like a lighthouse. Well, they were selling it so fast, they kept raising their prices. It got to the point where the owner's like, I can't do it anymore. I feel bad, but the whole thing's been sold out. So they're like, I'm not going to raise it anymore, and it was sold out like in a year. Just crazy. Because somebody bought it, then they told somebody else, so somebody else wanted to buy space, and it just took around. And I've had that happen with other cremation gardens too, where they just to manage how fast people are buying it, they've raised the prices a little bit. Or they've changed prices, you know, on different products or brought in different products. But that's the other thing too. If you build something ahead of time, if you put in 50% of the product, or whatever you put in a percentage, you can always adjust it. So if you find out, for example, that the cremation pillars are selling faster than the benches, you can change it so you're putting more pillars in and less benches, etc. Okay. But I one of the things that I've seen over and over in my travels is, I see it all the time, cemetery has an area, that's our cremation area, they plop a columbarium in it, they got all these other great ideas, but it's not selling. It's not selling. They go out and they show families, but maybe they're selling some spots in the niches. But as far as the other things that they want to sell them, they want to sell them a boulder, they want to sell them a bench, they want to sell them these things. They're like, Raymond, they're not. Nobody's biting. Nobody's buying them. I'm like, well, all I see is a columbarium stuck out here. I see nothing else. There's nothing here to attract me to this area. You've got, so that it does help if you're able to put some of those products in. Anybody else have any ideas, advice? So anybody have a real big cremation area in your cemetery? Yes?
We have a big cremation area compared to anything else in our cemetery area, but it's not selling.
It's not selling.
So what people will do, initially it required flush stones, so I've actually come up with an idea to sell two of the mid or two of the plots together and they can put a slant on it.
Okay.
People say they like it, but I've only had one sale since then.
Okay.
What they're doing is they're buying a full burial spot, saying they're going to have a full burial, and then they lie and they put it in the cremation.
Okay.
So that's my struggle right now, so I'm trying to, maybe we can put a couple trees in there, beautify it, or do something.
Yeah, I mean, obviously making it very attractive is the key. And then the other thing is we got a room full of cemeterians that could probably help you with some ideas on getting that going. But I know just that when I first started with Cold Spring, you know, 20 years ago, cemeteries were just starting to put columbariums in. And, you know, you'd sell that 48-inch columbarium and they'd plop it out there and the thing wouldn't sell. It wouldn't sell. So they call us up and said, you know, we're not selling anything. And I'd say, well, let me send you 3 or 4 bronze plaques, put them up there, put a bench out there. And when you did that, then people see activity like, oh, there are people buying into that. Then it would start to take off. So my point on that is it's probably doing something to get that ball rolling, and then it becomes a snowball effect if it starts taking off. So, yeah. So I would reach out to some of the other people here, probably could give you some ideas on.
It was a great idea 17 years ago. It just didn't.
Yeah, and if it's been there, that, okay. Yeah.
And it goes in spurts. I'll have like 5 people buy, and then I won't. And then I will. Same thing with our columbariums. Yeah. Right now I've got 3 columbariums. One's completely full, one front is sold out, and on the back. And people will kill to get in the one that is sold on the top row. That's all they want is the top row.
Right.
So, not selling that until another one's filled.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah, and through that process you're discovering what people like and what they don't, and and if you can, you know, marketing is the key, right? Too, if you have the ability to market it, let people know that it's there. You know, a few years ago there was a gentleman that gave a presentation, and to me he was right on with this whole presentation. But he said, you know, 20, 30 years ago, families needed it. Families needed cemeteries. They needed to have a final resting spot. But he said, today, guess what? They don't need you. They don't need you, and a lot of people don't want you. So his whole thing was that this industry, or you have to market yourself. And once a cemetery brought him in, because this was a very large cemetery, and they hired this gentleman to help them with the marketing, and they did make tremendous progress, you know, in their marketing campaigns and getting people to be, you know, aware of what's available in the cemetery and why they should memorialize. And that's the key. So cremation garden or anything you do, obviously, how are you going to market that? How are you going to let people know that it's there? Because unfortunately, as we know, a lot of people leave the funeral home, they take the cremains home, and they don't think about it. And I've had a lot of discussions with people. It's like, you know, mom and dad just want to be cremated. I got them at home. They're in the closet and all of that. And I love to say, well, that's good. But what happens if you have a fire? If they tell me they're in the basement, I hope your basement doesn't flood. And they look at you kind of funny. It's like, well, you know, it happens because people tell me it happens. That, you know, they had a fire and they lost everything. Plus they lost mom and dad. Good. Anything else anybody has? Okay, well, there are several brochures from both my company, Matthews, and from Cold Spring. And obviously, there's lots of other granite companies and bronze companies that have these products too. But feel free to take some of those with you if you'd like to give you ideas. My card is back there also if you ever have any questions on cremation or cremation gardens, please give me a call. Thank you.